In this video, I'm going to show you how to use brushes to add dramatic clouds to your photos. Specifically, we'll be working with this original unedited photo from the Yosemite National Park, and by the end of this video, we'll have transformed it into this final version where the clouds are a lot more dramatic, and we've done that using brushes, and we've also been able to use brushes to make the half dome, which is the big mountain, brighter. So we've used brushes for two reasons here. One is to make the clouds more dramatic, and number two is to also make this mountain stand out more in this darker photo. So this is an example of the kind of edits you can do with brushes. So now, let's open up the Snapseed app and let's get started. So now that I've opened the photo we're going to work with, the first thing I'd like to do is open the brush tool. So when it comes to selective adjustments, generally speaking, you'll get better results if you do the selective adjustments first. Now, this is different from Vignette, which we just covered in the previous video, and Vignette is generally a great last step. But when it comes to brushes, from my experience, you'll get better results if you apply brushes early on in the edit. So for this photo, I don't need to rotate anything. I don't need any additional cropping. So I'm ready to go straight to the brushes tool, and the brushes tool is located right here together with all the other edits. So I'm just going to tap my finger here and the brush tool opens. So by default, this menu will come up at the bottom, and it gives you four different options for the brush tool. And I've played around with all of them, but the only one that I've found to be useful is the dodge and burn tool. You can definitely play around with the other ones to see how they work, but from my experience, the dodge and burn is the only one that's really relevant to us. So to close this menu, all I have to do is just tap somewhere on the screen, and now that menu goes away. And let me quickly explain how dodge and burn works. So currently at the bottom of the screen, you can see that the dodge and burn value is set to plus 10. And what this essentially means is that as I move my finger over the photo, those parts of the photo gradually become brighter. And that's what the plus 10 stands for. If I take it down to minus 10, for example, and if I then move my finger over those parts of the image, they become darker and darker, like so. And that's essentially how the dodge and burn tool works. Now, at the bottom right, there's the eye icon. So if you tap your finger there, this allows you to see the areas of the photo you've affected thus far. And you'll see the two red areas on the left, which is where we added the dodge and burn. Now, if you'd like to erase that, you have to take the dodge and burn tool to zero at the bottom using these two arrows. So I'm just gonna take it to eraser, which is what's shown there instead of zero. And if I now erase all this red area, we're back to the original image without any modifications. So my goal in this photo is to really emphasize the dark clouds above the beautiful mountain. So in order to do that, I'm gonna have to go negative with my dodge and burn values. And I've found that I get the best results if I use minus 5 as opposed to minus 10, because this just gives me more control. So if I now zoom in a little bit on the clouds, if I just move my finger over the clouds, you'll see that they're being selected in red, but you don't really see what happens. So I'm gonna untap the eye icon at the bottom right, and now you'll see that as I move my finger over these clouds, they gradually get darker. If I only move my finger once, they get a little bit darker, but then as I keep moving my finger over the same areas, they become increasingly darker and darker. So my goal here is to essentially make all the clouds darker, but I want to do it in such a way that is reasonable and where the clouds still look natural. I think this is an improvement, so if we do a quick before and after, then this is before dodge and burn and this is after. But I'm really not seeing the full picture because I don't see which areas I have selected and which ones I haven't. So I'm going to tap on the eye icon again, and this time I'd like to make sure that I've selected all the clouds more or less accurately. But I have to be a bit careful because if I travel over the same areas too many times, they become darker and darker, and there's a chance of overdoing this effect. Now, the good thing about dodge and burn is that it's kind of intelligent, and it doesn't just make everything in the photo darker. Instead, it will look for dark pixels in the photo, and it will only make the dark pixels darker. So it ends up being a very, very natural way to make certain parts of the image brighter or darker because if you're going darker, it will only darken the photo, the pixels that are already a little bit dark. So this might be good. So just to verify what it looks like, I'm going to tap the eye icon again. And it looks like I've done a pretty good job in terms of darkening the clouds. So we do a before and after. This is before dodge and burn, and this is after. And I think it looks very accurate. And I'm happy with the changes we've made here. Now, before we leave this tool, I'd like to do something very similar, but this time I'd like to work with the half dome mountain. So I like how it's illuminated in the sunlight, or at least partially illuminated, and I'd like to emphasize that more. So what I'm going to do is change the dodge and burn value from -5 to +5 using the arrows at the bottom. And now that we're at +5, I'm going to zoom in some more, and I'm going to essentially paint over the bright parts of the mountain. Now, obviously, I can't see what's happening, so I'm going to have to turn the eye on again. And my goal is to just cover everything smoothly so that everything is just a little bit pink, but not too much, because if it's too much, it's probably not going to look natural. I have gone over the edges a little bit, and generally speaking, it's not a big problem with the dodge and burn tool. But just to make sure it all works out perfectly, I'll open the eraser by tapping on the down arrow. So that takes it to 0, which is eraser. And I'll just erase everything that's outside of the mountain, just to be sure. All right, I think I've erased all the places where we went over the edges. So now it's done. And if we now tap on the eye icon again, you'll see that the mountain has been made a tiny bit brighter. And if we do a quick before and after, this is before dodge and burn, this is after. So the mountain stands out more, but it's still perfectly natural, which is what's important in all these edits. So if we zoom out and if we do another before and after, this is before dodge and burn, this is after. And you can see how we've been able to use this tool to make certain parts of the image darker, specifically the clouds, so that they look more extreme and stand out more. While on the other hand, we've made the mountain brighter, which also makes it stand out more in this composition. And that's the power of the dodge and burn tool. So now I'm going to go ahead and apply these changes. And now we can continue the edit by quickly visiting the Tune Image module. So inside the Tune Image, there are a handful of things I'd like to do. And the first one is the shadows. So I'm going to select shadows, and if you look at the histogram at the bottom left, you'll see that there is literally nothing on the left-hand side of the histogram. So that to me tells that shadows can definitely be decreased a little bit. And actually, I can go pretty low, and something like -40 might work well for this image. I don't want to go too low because that emphasizes the clouds even more. And while it does look cool, I have to make sure that the edit looks natural at the end of the day. Any of these editing tools, if you overuse them, you just reduce the quality of your photos and they just don't look good. So don't overdo any of these edits, and let's stick to a relatively modest value of -40, because we could go much lower if we wanted to. Next up, I'd like to go down to warmth, and for this photo, since I'm really going for this dramatic look where the clouds are dark and ominous, what I want to do is essentially also create the same kind of mood in terms of color scheme. And to do that, I'm going to decrease warmth. So as I decrease warmth, the image becomes bluer. And I'm going to decrease it just a little bit to something like -7. I like this value because now the clouds are clearly blue, but we can still see some hint of sunshine on the back of the mountain. And that combination is what I like about this photo. So if we do a quick before and after, then this is before Tune Image. And as I release my finger, this is after Tune Image, and you'll see that the photo has once again become more dramatic, and the blue tones work better, at least in my opinion. So what I'm going to do now is apply these changes, and I'd like to do one more step, and I will be vignetting. So I'm going to tap on the edit icon again and open the vignette module. And once again, vignette comes last in the order of edits. And here, there's just one part of the image that's substantially brighter than the rest, and that is the half dome mountain itself. So I'm going to take the circle and I'm going to move it to the middle of the mountain like so. Once I'm happy with the position of the circle, I can start playing around with the size of the circle as well as the inner and outer brightness. Now, in terms of size, I've played around with this photo before, and I found that I don't have to make it too big. Something like plus 30 does the trick for me. And in terms of inner and outer brightness, I want to make sure I don't overdo this. Now, I'm not looking to change the value of inner brightness because I'm happy with the way it is right now, but the default outer brightness value of minus 50 is too strong for me. So I'm going to try to make this effect a little bit weaker, but I still like the overall direction where this is going, so I'm going to leave it at minus 40 or so. I think at minus 40 we've sort of achieved a good balance where you don't really see the vignetting, but it can still be felt in terms of the mood of the photo. So if we do a quick before and after, this is before vignetting, and this is after vignetting, and I think we have made an improvement. So I'm going to go ahead and apply these changes. And now, if we go full screen, let's do a quick before and after again. So this is before the edit, and you'll see how the image looks kind of dull. And as I release my finger, this is after the edit, where the colors are so much better, the clouds are more dramatic, and also the bright half of the Halfdale Mountain stands out more. So it looks like a great improvement, but it does come with a cost, and that cost is actually grain. So if we zoom in on the clouds, you'll see that the clouds tend to be a little bit grainy, and this happens for a few reasons here. Number one is because this photo was shot in smoky conditions, which introduced some grain in the original, but then this grain was further amplified by the editing we've done. Now, the grain isn't a huge problem, so if I were to share this on social media, I'd be perfectly fine, but I would be a little bit more hesitant to make a large-scale print out of this edit because the grain will be clearly seen on the print. So you can still print it, of course, but just know that the grain will be there because this editing process has amplified the grain that was already in the original photo. But now that we know that, I'm still very happy with the edit we've created, so I'm going to go ahead and save my work.